Okay, so this session is on Discovery, our Discovery Roundtable. My name's Chris Beckett. I'm a VP of Business Development, looking after the European and rest of the world market. And we have on our panel today, and they will introduce themselves very briefly, Dave Martinson, Anne Michael, and Roger Williams. So do you want to just say who you are, what you do, kind of thing?
What's that? I'm Dave Martinson from the American Chemical Society. I've been there for, I don't know, 26 or so years, and working in a digital publishing strategy role now. I've been in IT. I've worked in the old dial-up online systems, CD-ROM, the early days of the web. And prior to that, I did some work in database curation and search systems. Prior to coming to ACS.
Anne Michael, and I'm with DeltaThink, a publishing consultancy, and I know a lot of you. We do a lot of digital publishing strategy and execution, so a lot of things around vendor selection, implementation, process reengineering, all that kind of stuff too.
Roger Williams with AIAA. I'm the managing director on technical publications, so I'm kind of representing the publisher and content side here. Been there 19 years, and relatively new client of Adapon, hoping to launch in midsummer.
Going to launch.
Yes, going to launch, yes. It's been hoping for a long time, so.
Okay. So, it's interesting. When you start looking around for definitions of discoverability, as I did, you can get a regular, or discovery, you can get a regular definition from a dictionary and, about finding stuff. And I suppose that's interesting because it's a distinction that we probably ought to make this afternoon in between findability and discoverability. Because findability, certainly when we've discussed it in preparation for this session, is being able to find a thing, to being able to find a book chapter, a book, an article. It's a kind of fairly direct you search and you go there. And then discoverability is all of the other services that sit around that article or object after you've located it, which provide you with more and perhaps better similar or related information. And so discoverability isn't just for looking, it's not just looking, it's about all of the other services that go with that. But in pursuit of all of that, rather amusingly, I went to, what are you gonna do if you want to know about discoverability? Well, you're gonna go to Google, because the main change in discoverability in the last 15 years is Google. So I went to Google and put in discoverability, and it was a real hoot, actually, because the first article that comes up is the myth of discoverability. So you go to the most successful discoverability engine of all time, put in discoverability, and you go, that's a myth. So you'll be glad to know that Google's a myth. But before Google, and even still, if you go to a whole series of websites in our space, this is a library website, you tend to get this kind of stuff. Maybe users used to go through and read all of these kind of instructions as to how to find things how to do discovery. You can do keyword searching, do subject searching, and all the way through this rather turgid description, which I can't imagine anyone actually reading, you come across words, you put in this term, this descriptor, this word. And I think the problem with that is that now that's not how the world is seen to work. In the mass market, these are all things that I use in the mass market, Amazon, Spotify, and iTunes. The machine actually does the discovery for me to a considerable extent. I go to Amazon and Amazon said, well, we're not even sure what you're looking for, but hey, this is what you want. And they're not wrong a lot of the time. Similarly, iTunes, of course, does that with its Genius Bar kind of approach, and Spotify does it as well. So recommendation engines are, I suppose, and personalized targeting, which is something that Kevin spoke about earlier this morning, is very much part of everyone who's on the web's experience in their general experience. And I think there was a period where you could separate that out. We used to live in this space which was the scholarly website. And the scholarly website was presumed to be in some way different from the mass market website. And I think that's a distinction that's broken down, and that the expectation, if it's not there now, will soon very much be there from users, that they're going to see those kind of facilities in on those kind of sites. So what that boils down to is that users expect sites to deliver relevant content in the right format, in the right context, i.e. in their workflow. That's all I want to say as part of an introduction. And we are looking for a similarly interactive and successful session as that that Nash organized before lunch. We have organized, or I have, and we've discussed some of the kind of key areas that we think discoverability needs to really kind of look at hard. So I've got one question, and I'm going to flash them up here just so you know what, because the way I say questions, you'll never remember what the question is, so it's just as well it's written down. And I thought, just to kick off, we'd talk about mobile and discoverability, because we think that's, well, mobile is clearly on the up, so the question of discoverability in the mobile context is clearly important. So the first question, and you can all chip in, preferably not at the same time, is discoverability relevant in a mobile environment, or is mobile all about findability? Guys, who's next?
So I, Chris actually took a couple slides out of here.
I know.
And yeah. I was thinking on the way over here this morning, because we're talking about discovery, and so the first title slide says something about discovery roundtable, and then we get into this word discoverability. And it seems to me that there's two different perspectives that each of those terms brings. So discovery is an action or a task that I do to find something, and discoverability is something that I am or that our content is. In one sense, our users, our researchers are out there trying to discover things that are relevant to them. And on the other hand, we as publishers are trying to help them find material on our site that they will click on and stick around and view. And those two sides of the coin may be at counter purposes to each other. So I want to draw them in and keep them here as long as possible, and they want to find the information they need as quickly as possible and get away and get back to their work. On the other hand, a researcher also has an aspect of discoverability. So when I'm at whatever stage I am in my career, I want other people to be able to discover me and see the work that I've done and the impact, the contributions I've made to the science. So that there still is on the researcher's side, an aspect of both of those components. So I guess looking at mobile, is discoverability the same thing as findability? Is discovery the same thing as finding? I think at the extremes there probably are some differences, but when you get kind of into the intermediate level, I think I know what I'm looking for. It's not exactly, I can't find it exactly with a Google search. I need to refine some terms. I'll flip from findable mode to discovery mode. And maybe there's some different strategies applied there to how wide I cast the net. If I'm just looking to find something, straightforward terms or citation search, discoverability, I may broaden terms, use these automated topic models to do discovery. So, discovery, discoverability, some different nuances.
So I think kind of building on what you said, David, and what was implicit in that were use cases. So when you think about mobile, I guess the question is, why is someone using a mobile device is really the question that someone's asking here, because they're either using it for findability, which I would argue is finding a specific thing. I know what I want, I'm going to get it, I'm going to get out. And if I can't find it and it causes me to have to do faceted search, that's actually, you know, a failure. I want to get it to somebody as quickly as possible because they had that one purpose, versus I'm a little bit more in the mode of I kind of want to know about a topic, or I know I want to know something, but I don't know exactly what it is. And it isn't a specific article. It isn't, you know, a specific definition of a term. It's I need to know something about X, and I want to see, well, what are my options to learn about X? And again, it gets back to a use case, and it also gets back to how you define mobility. So when you think about a smartphone and you think about discoverability versus findability, you can say, well, discoverability is a tough use case on such a tiny bit of real estate. You think about a tablet, though, and that's mobile, and that's a little bit easier to deal with and to build in features that would encourage or promote discoverability. So I guess yes is the answer, Chris.
And to follow up a little bit on what Anne said, and I think in our first conversation we talked about if you get that element of serendipity in mobile, you have to find a way to make it notable, refindable in another environment when you have the chance to explore further. I think Anne made an excellent point, though. The tablet does bring you into a more immersive opportunity for research, and so discoverability has maybe a higher priority in a tablet environment than in a smartphone or a small phone.
Okay. So I think the answer is yes. What does anyone in the room think about discoverability in mobile? Have you got any particular experiences or feedback? What's your personal use of trying to do discoverability on phones?
And that has always surprised us, right? Because we never, I remember the time when they thought, this is pre-Twitter even, when no one's going to read more than just a couple of sentences on a mobile, on a handheld device, on a mobile phone. And now people are reading the New York Times every day on a mobile phone. So I think increasingly discoverability is going to be done on the most useful device, and that might be a 3-inch screen or a 7-inch screen or 20-inch screen.
Any other thoughts from anyone else? Okay. Any other questions right off the bat? No? So one of the other things that we thought was potentially of interest is article level metrics. So I'm sure many of you have been on or are well aware of the PLOS site. And the work that PLOS has done, I mean, other people have done it as well, but I think they probably did it first, on combining a whole series of different metrics, citations, web usage, expert ratings, social bookmarking, community rating, blog coverage, commenting activity. All of these things are almost facets of the article that you can see on their site. And I thought when I was looking at their site, I can see it's useful, but I wasn't entirely clear. I was useful in evaluating the content once you were there, but what the impact might be on discoverability itself.
One thing that came to mind when we first started talking about this, it was the combination, and it's a topic we'll get into later, so I don't want to jump too far ahead, but particularly on commenting activity is the ability to data mine maybe the source of those that. And it went to one of the points in the last session about how public scholars who are maybe in a more competitive mindset are waiting for that credibility to come to them, factor that in. And for AAA in particular, with our content, we're serving a large corporate and a very competitive corporate market in the aerospace and defense. So finding a way to do some protection, but also discoverability within those closed networks may be part of the answer that, and relates definitely to this kind of alt metrics I think we're looking at.
So in looking at some of the things that we talked about that are up there, I think some of them are about rating content, and the reality is discoverability is an equation that involves content and the user. So getting back to the user, And so I think that maybe some of the metrics that have to be combined with these metrics go back to things that Kevin was talking about this morning, about who these people are, what they're interested in, what they're doing right now, the whole like last three clicks. And then when you can combine that and use these kinds of statistics or, you know, this kind of information to then surface the things that are most relevant to that person at the time that they are, you know, working in the system to accomplish a goal, which unfortunately you don't really know until they're there because they could come with a different goal every time, then these things I think are really valuable. But again, they're part of the equation. So the article or the content obviously is just half of the part of discoverability, or maybe I don't even know what, maybe it doesn't even have, you know, the real big issue is what's someone trying to accomplish, what are they trying to do, and then how do you line these up, these metrics up on your content to serve up the right thing at the right time.
Yeah, there are a lot of different factors involved in each of these items. And one comment particularly on web usage, because that is one that is gaining some traction in the scholarly community at large, and looking at whether there is some relationship between usage patterns and impact factors, usage being very much an early indicator, and impact citations and impact factor being a lagging indicator. So can we get a better idea of what the relevant or high impact articles are by looking at usage early on? And I know on our site we do have listings of the most read articles where whether read equals download is open to question, but in some sense, the highlights of the most used articles are kind of become a cycle, almost a self-fulfilling cycle. So if you list these as the most downloaded, then people are going to click on them, which will mean they will continue to be the most downloaded. And those that didn't make it into that early stage of heavy usage get penalized because of that. The fact that an article is downloaded a lot doesn't necessarily mean that it's relevant to my research. There could be a lot of reasons, and in fact, a lot of negative reasons that articles get downloaded a lot. So that's just one aspect of caution in the heavy reliance on some of the social media types of metrics in terms of aiding discoverability. So they may increase discoverability, they may actually decrease discoverability if the goal is to find the article or content that is most relevant to my work.
Is there anyone in the audience got any questions or follow-up questions that relate to that? The alt metrics approach. It's certainly true that in the more general user space, in my life anyway, I've discovered, because it's a most read something on probably the Financial Times, since I kind of read that a lot. I didn't realize what bloviating ignoramus meant until very recently, but evidently it's a... Yeah, no. They said it to Donald Trump. I assumed it was something to do with his hairdo, but it's not. It's actually being a bit of a windbag, and that was all because of it was at the top of a most read article, and so I read it. You know, not that I really care about Donald Trump. Okay. Fragmentation. What's the? There is a whole process going on of digital first, XML first, identifying all of the components of what was traditionally a single unitary piece, i.e. the article. So breaking out the tables, breaking out the figures. What impact, I can see how that has benefit for the user in terms of I just want to get this this figure, or I just want to get this table, but what actually does that do to discovery, if anything? You want to have a go? You sure? You sure?
Well, actually, I'm going to reframe your question. So, just for a change. Well, you it was interesting. You're saying, what does it do for the user? And if I'm looking for something and I can find it, and I find something to be a boon to my productivity, I'm going to go back again and again and again. So it's not necessarily bad that someone isn't consuming an article and all of its pieces and all of its parts. It's actually great if through semantic tagging and through the idea that I can relay a topic to a website and get to something that's very useful to me very quickly. It's not only, that's the whole point we're talking about discoverability, because the reason we're talking about discoverability is because users want to find what they want, and they want to be, even when they don't know exactly what it is, as opposed to, you know, the findable thing. And if we accomplish that, if we help them accomplish that goal, I think that that's a user that's going to come back and do it again. This
way? Yeah, so I would say I take it up one level further in terms of the fragmentation. So when we were still in the print world, the goal was, yeah, articles, but it was also journals. And so people would sit down in their office or in the library and page through the, at least the table of contents, but maybe even page through the journal. So we have seen a fragmentation in separating the articles from the, at least an aggregated journal context. We still are very much aware that we need to preserve the journal brand, because that has cachet in the community, and the people that are reading our material still very much rely on that journal brand. But we've broken articles away. We publish article by article, and then by the time the issue comes out, for those of us who still do issues, most people have already seen that stuff. But then if we go to the next step, how has fragmenting the article had an impact, or has it? And I think one of the things that we've seen, when we talk with students, we talk with editors, we talk with researchers, and I think starting out in certain communities, there was the idea that, you know, the abstract is good, the title is good, the author list is important, but we often make a decision on whether to read an article or not based on figures. So I think, I don't know, was it before when we went to Literatum that we actually started putting a table of contents graphic out there? And so people began to read through the tables of contents or their search results, and really looking at the graphics as to make their decision of whether to invest the time, the further time, to consume the entire article. And then we saw kind of a side effect of that. We had people coming to us and say, we know that graphic is important, so can you give us some advice on how to make a graphic that will be compelling and actually make people want to take that next step? So that kind of feeds into the authors want to be discoverable. They know that it's important to them to have their work read, and so we take some new concept and put it out into the wild, and then people pick that up and adjust to it and make some changes in their own behavior, and then that comes back. And so we're in kind of this evolutionary spiral, so to speak, keeping one step ahead of our users, and our users keeping one step ahead of their competitors in research. And so an aid to discover, on our standpoint, an aid to make our articles more discoverable becomes then almost a requirement for the researchers themselves to make their work stand out from the crowd.
Let me just follow up on one point. It struck me as we were sitting here is that the idea of fragmentation is not particularly new, particularly in scholarly journals. I mean, how many of us have had journals spin off as a certain thread of a scope began to overtake and overpopulate the journals? So I think this is just taking it a natural progression down as technology keeps up, makes it more immediate and more flexible in a way. And also to the point about the illustration, I mean, even ProQuest and traditional A&I group is now trying to separate out the figures in Illustrata and add additional, you know, discoverability from searching those illustrations.
And I think that actually speaks also to the point that was talked about in the tech roundtable this morning about, you know, are you in a content business, or are you in a technology business, or do you have to be, is that a false dichotomy? Are you necessarily in a in the business of enhancing content with value-added technology features, whether that's just, you know, the kind of virtuous circle that you were talking about, which feeds well into the authors, but also feeds well into the discoverability and the usage. So, okay, so the answer to that is yes as well. That's good. Really? Okay.
So how many of you have done some kind of, what are the names, article reboot, article of the future, article improvement project, article, how many have done that where you've re-examined how you present an article? Oh, I know more of you have done than that.
How many have done it internally, if not externally?
Well, so let me ask you this. How many of you are exploring fragmentation of your articles, being able to offer them into different pieces in different places? Why are some of you doing that? All right, you had your hands up. Now you can't put them down.
My sense is strongly that people do a lot of research by just typing words into Google boxes or, you know, one-word search boxes on Wikipedia. Figures, as you mentioned, are kind of hard to find at the moment. Figures in particular, it's not just the fact that they're graphics, but sometimes the best caption you get from your author is figure one, useless. I think in general, people are looking for the smallest bit of information that kind of satisfies the need for that answer, and then they're ready to move on to the next thing. I often read a full article and maybe even link through to another source, but that initial hit is the thing that is going to get people. If you can satisfy that, then maybe they'll stick around and do those other things. If you're not satisfying that, they're back to Google and they've moved on. So we want to make, I want to make things stickier.
Do you enrich those pieces and parts, or do you plan to? In some way, semantically?
Plan to, hope to, haven't figured out how yet, but it's certainly in my mind that that's a place I need to go. Don't yet know what that workflow is going to be that will accomplish that in a cost-effective, time-effective way, but that's the next part of the next set of questions, yeah.
We're at Emerald. We're in a kind of fairly early stage of trying to break up our content into new format types. An example, we've gone out to our the most downloaded articles, invited those authors to kind of submit a kind of video abstract almost. And I think it's really kind of just a way of adding context to the traditional article. But I think moving forward, we probably just need to explore from the fragmentation point of view how we can make it easier for people to cite those kind of different formats, multimedia, podcasts, videos. And then by doing that, we can make the research process a lot quicker for them and save time and just make the whole process a lot more efficient.
Okay.
So yeah, we're doing a lot to enrich our, well, we're doing a lot of planning around enriching our content and the different forms that it can be broken down. And we're using kind of separating out tables, separating out photos and other multimedia. I'm not sure what else I had to add, Anne. You probably do.
I'll just add something from ACS's perspective as well. We have this sister division to our primary publications, Chemical Abstracts, and their mission is to separate out specific fragments, which they then make available through their own search systems. It's kind of separated in the sense that and we publish our track of journals. They're doing this breaking out chemical structures, chemical reactions, taxonomy terms, methods, and they're than building a search system. The abstracts as well are in there from their name. And so then they enable a discovery layer across publishers that is built upon those fragments. So rather than doing it ourselves and having it within our own site, we have a partner, if you will, that's doing that. I guess maybe I'll stop there. I want to say about the questions going forward. I was going to say at the beginning that some of the views I present here may not necessarily be those of my employers. So. Okay, but that's where I'll stop now.
And we assume that's true.
Yeah.
Of us, actually,
except Anne.
In case there was any. Except Anne. Right. There aren't any risks, are there, to this fragmentation? Oh, sorry.
Hey, Anne, seeing as you mentioned Article of the Future, I thought I should say something because I think Elsevier came up with that name, which I hate. I think the thinking with Article of the Future was more around adding value to the article rather than discoverability. Bearing in mind that, you know, there's multiple copies of the article, you can go to PubMed Central to get it. So what can we add to the article so it'll keep the user there, increase the value of their subscription, and embed, you know, other tools into that workflow? So it's kind of more about adding value to the article, I would say.
Are there any risks to the fragmentation of content? Does it threaten the integrity of the article? Because clearly you might be pulling it apart for discoverability reasons or even to add value, as Mark was saying, but does it suggest that, I don't know, that you can kind of get all you need out of a figure or get all of you need out of an abstract will get out all you need out of a paragraph, doesn't have a kind of more disruptive effect on the kind of whole process of understanding and reading, or is am I just being a hippie here? Oh yeah. Right. Well, it just seems to me that it's just a whole fragmentation of all of our experience in the web. It's becoming more staccato, I think is probably the right adjective, and rather than linear. And that's assumed to be a good thing, but I'm personally not sure, but then that might just be me. No? Oh, okay.
I agree that you do have a couple of risks. One is, by chopping information up into small bits, people do think that they know the whole because they've seen a tiny piece of the part. And there is also the risk that if you're putting that stuff out free to kind of attract people into the content, and they think they've gotten all they need to know, then they won't stick around and they won't purchase content or engage in any of the other behaviors that we may want to have. Going back to the Dark Ages, when I was in law school and was first introduced to the concept of keywords, which was already in heavy use then for all cases, they were all they all had keyword citations. We were warned strenuously that just using a keyword to find content, appropriate cases to cite, and then going right straight to that point might mean that you miss the point, because an awful lot of things in the law were done by analogy. And one thing that you could, if you got too stuck on the fact that the product was a chair instead of the product was a table, instead of the fact that somebody's fallen off of it and what you're talking about is product liability issues, then you were kind of missing the point, because there might not be a case on tables, but there might be 50 cases on chairs. So if you get too wound up with, my case is about a table, and there's no content on tables, you can miss the whole thing. And I think that is probably true in nearly every specialty. And it's not that you don't want to granularize or fragment content, but I think there does need to be a bit of an awareness, and that may be where some of the you might also be interested in recommendation engines, relevance, where some of those features that are associated with that come in, and to make sure that those continue to be attached in a prominent and effective way.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point.
I came up against this problem recently with a new journal we have where we're going to accompany each article with a video, and the editor of the journal insisted that just having one video that sort of brings the reader into the article was simply not enough. What we had to do instead was to create 6 or 8 videos for each and every figure and table in the paper. And he was absolutely insistent about it, and I didn't think it was the right way to go because I don't like that kind of fragmentation at all. I think it takes away from the whole. But one thing that I've really been thinking about, and of course we're kind of moving inexorably in this direction, is that some of the most important things in the scientific discovery process are things that you were never looking for. And I think that's true in a lot of things that we all find. Or things that are most interesting are things that we weren't looking for. So I think the narrow casting is of concern, but we're certainly moving in that direction.
Excellent. Any other contributions on this particular question? Okay, I'll move on to the next one. Right. We started to get we boiled down some of the questions last night in the bar, and this was our best result. It was a very, very long-winded question beforehand, and after a couple of beers, we thought this was a better way of putting it. So, do publishers need to read their users' minds? And if so, how? Off you go, guys.
Well, I think in a way, part of what Kevin covered this morning really leapt over this. I was thinking we may not even have to address this question after the discussion this morning.
Nice.
I think we all got into it.
Clearly, literati was already sold.
Exactly. So, but I think certainly one thing that we're very curious about is how to bridge the gap between an academic researcher and a practitioner. And for us, that's usually a BA engineer who's come out relatively new, has told us in focus groups that they feel woefully unprepared for what they're being asked to do and don't know how to relate to the scholarly content. So I think there is a need to be able to do that and do that better.
And how?
That's what I'm waiting for everybody else to answer.
That's your question.
Yes.
You're stuttering. So this was really a really long question, and the question originally had to do, I think, with things about we were talking about tagging and anticipating user needs, profiling, and all those kinds of things, and it came down to the fact that users kind of expect you to read their mind, and then they're scared as hell when you do. So I think Kevin's tie example, although you took it like a man, Kevin, when your tie showed up, that would really freak some people out. So one of the things we started talking about, also related to this, was privacy. So do publishers need to read their users' minds? And I would say probably to some extent yes, but very carefully, because we don't want to scare them away. And how? I think a lot of it is through things like, we've been talking about, the topic modeling and the being ways to the idea of fingerprinting, which even sounds scary, Kevin. Maybe you can call it something else. Like, fingerprinting articles, fingerprinting, user behavior, putting it all together. But as long as it's productive, I don't think it'll be too scary. As long as it's really helping somebody do something faster. And at the end of the day, that's what most people want to do. We're not talking about the lean back users here. We're talking about, I have a problem, and the faster you can help me solve it, the happier I will be, and I don't care what the chunk you gave me. You solve my problem, I'll come back.
Yeah, I'll just add to the distillation of this question down to its current state. The last point of discussion was between Anne and Chris as to where the apostrophe went and whether mine should be singular or plural. The picture that I like came from Nick Bilton, who is a tech writer with the New York Times now. He was in their research group, and he wrote a book a couple of years back called What was it? I live in the future, and here's how it works. But he said that there was kind of a sea change when the smartphone came out. And in the old days, we used to get a map, and we'd have to first decipher that map and figure out where we were on that map, and then We had to find where we were going and figure out how to get there. Now we open up our smartphone and look at Google Maps, and we're in the center of that map. So now apply that principle to whatever environment you find yourself in. So I come to a publisher site, and I want to be in the middle. I want that site to revolve around my needs and my interests. If we look at it on the publisher side, we're delivering web pages, and that web page might be an article, that web page might be a video, it might be some other piece of content. Well, that's now a center that can be used as a launch point to other places. So it's kind of a moving center. As the users come to us, they're at the center of their current experience, and they're going to go someplace else, and they're going to leave a trail behind them. In the same way, we're going to give them some navigation features that will hopefully take them someplace that they need to get to. And so how do we mesh those two centers so that it comes to really give the user the experience they need?
And that is about profiling users one way or another and profiling content in order to make those navigational links pertinent. Is there a question there?
Well, actually, I have an opinion on the question up there, which is with the user's full knowledge and consent. That's the answer. And I point to a recent announcement by Twitter to fully support what's called Do Not Track, which is a header that's used in all browsers. And their policy, if you actually read it, is a wonderful template for how to do it right. They're very clear, open, this is what we're doing, and we're giving you, the user, the ability to control. We'll provide you information that you may find useful, but if you don't want to be bothered, you can turn it off. And I think that's something that we should learn from, because I think if there's anything a user wants and expects, it's respect for their own decisions. If we do it without their consent, they'll scream, they'll yell, and they'll run the other way. So
I think that's an excellent point. And in fact, it probably also speaks now to the European Directive on Privacy, which has obliged, certainly in Europol websites, to put those cookies up. I mean, I think the interesting question there is going to be, if everyone behaves like me, you kind of go, yeah, that's fine, bang, get me to what I want to do. And so, but you absolutely have to make the offer, and it has to be a clear one. I think you're quite right. Any other comments on this particular question? Good. Well, we shall move on to the next one, which also has some apostrophe challenges, if I'm not mistaken. Oh no! Send us the one after this. It's the use of.
Probably be worded.
No, I didn't. It was there was a question about do or does, if you remember. So what role? Yeah, this is it. What role does or what role do? Yeah, okay. What role do you see social media have? What role do you see social media having? See, no, in improving discoverability of content. Most of the discussion last night was, in fact, along this line, about the use of language.
What does you see doesn't work
either. No, I know. But anyway, don't let's go there again. So you kind of get the drift. What role do you see social media having in improving discoverability of content?
Okay, fine. Well, I think it's very interesting that way back, even from my days back in Wolters Kluwer, every time we ever did, so before social media, before anything, every time we did a survey and we said to physicians, what is your number one source? Where do you go? The first time you have a question, where do you go? Every single one said, a colleague. All the time. It was like ridiculous. It was always the first, and then the other things went in there. And so I think when I think of social media, I think the evolution of your electronic colleague, I think of maybe networks that are closed or, and obviously you're not necessarily as a professional looking for anybody's opinion, but when you can start to get, involved and interacting with the people that you trust, I see that there could be a huge role for social media as far as discoverability, as far as pointing people to professionals, to resources that are going to support them. And I think in SSP, one of the sessions we had, someone categorized discoverability as search engines and social engines, which I thought was kind of interesting.
So this morning there was a little bit of a discussion in the roundtable about what we might call the open science movement, and are people going to post their lab notebook with research results dynamically, and that the world may not be ready for that. But I think that there's a different aspect to social media, which is around the discovery side. And so some of the more radical scientists who say we don't need journal editors, we don't need journals anymore, just let everybody throw their content out there and let the community decide what's valuable or not, are naive in some ways. But on the other hand, they do have kind of a either electronically, probably in many respects electronically now, a virtual community of friends that they trust. And they will highlight new articles that come out. They will be pointed to new articles that come out by their circle of trusted friends. So I think there's an aspect of social media which helps, because I self-select my friends. I know what their interests are. I know what research they're doing. And if they tell me that something's interested, I'll be more likely to think that it's relevant to my work than if some editor of Nature decided it was good. Well, maybe Nature isn't the right example, because they probably are looking at the premier journals first. Yeah, yeah. maybe next year. But at any rate, that there still is a hierarchy of journals, but those journals are still publishing a huge quantity of articles, and so we need some next-level filter, and whether that's algorithmic, that's one way to do it, but if it's human, by humans that are looking at it and recommending to their friends in a network-type social media environment, I see that as something that's happening now.
Just following on much of what both of my colleagues said is that, you know, social networking is now just in a new media. It's, you know, the departmental connections that students had with advisors did the same thing. So if they're reviewing work, you said you need to look at this reference as well. Peer review does that when the recommendations for additional references to be considered as part of their revisions. And again, when you get into a less academic and corporate environment, mentoring programs are going away because there's less time for senior staff members to step in with juniors. So I think that social networking in some capacity will have to take over place of things that the human interaction doesn't have. There's no time for that human interaction anymore, and it's just another media of providing it.
And are there specific examples in your spaces specifically, or that you've come across, Anne, or indeed in the environments that anyone in the room has come across of social media really doing that? I mean, I think Dave mentioned a couple. Here we go again. I did? Which one was that? Yes. Yes, I mean, the OUP one this morning is an example, but that was the only one I, you know, picked up on.
So what was interesting about the OUP example is when they spoke about it at Charleston, I think a couple of years ago, what they said was they actually had editors who, in their contracts, it was part of their responsibility to edit certain topics on Wikipedia. And in doing so, when they had appropriate references, they would then add those references. And because everybody knows that what you do is, yeah, you might go to Wikipedia, but then you go right down to the references, because you kind of half trust what's in there, but you want to go back to the other material. So, and that's why they saw such a big increase, that their referrals from Wikipedia increased by 40% after they started doing that. And I think that's a beautiful example of how someone said, I'm going to go where my users are, yeah, and I'm going to be there and hope some of them are going to come back.
Yeah, no, I think that's a very good point.
Yeah, I was just going to add an experience, and I mean, there's many anecdotal things that I could say from talking with people, but there's one very prominent blog in the chemistry space, actually the pharma space, called In the Pipeline. And this was a blogger. He would recount his some things about articles that he was reading, just kind of share his review of them. He would also talk about what was going on within his company, and they went through some layoffs and downsizing. And so he over the weeks and months and years, gathered a huge following, and became a significant thought leader in that area. And he was eventually contacted by our weekly news magazine, Chemical and Engineering News, and he, I think, was doing some blogging for them at one time. He's on, I think, on at one time was on their board. And so there's an example of social media being an avenue for someone to attract attention, to become, to have an impact, and then through that impact have other venues open to them.
I have a question. Did you want to ask something? Yeah. How many of you are membership organizations? A lot of you. And how many of you have some form of community, whether it's social networking or not, that you try to pull together? And in any of those communities, have you introduced social networking features, and to what end has that worked or not?
Our membership department was very active in putting together what they considered a social network. They did this because they claimed the membership wanted it, even though every bit of research the rest of us were reading said that the last thing that they needed was one more social network with one more profile and one more way to log in. But anyway, they had it. I believe there are probably five or six people using it, and apparently those five or six people are very enthusiastic about it. It does not appear to be attracting broad support. I will say that it's very early days, so if this is something that could be expected to catch on, you know, maybe it is a little bit premature to be making assessments around this. There are features that exist to do profiles and add your picture and do some other, you know, kind of things like that, but it's not anywhere near as robust as something like Facebook, or LinkedIn is actually much more popular in the profession that we deal with. And I think that the likelihood of this being a major long-term success is probably not high, because there are other ways of handling these kinds of linking, and there are more robust tools out there, and pretty much everybody knows that, you know. Huh? We did. Yeah, I will say that a lot of the members have themselves gone out and formed small groups in LinkedIn and other kinds of connections with Twitter and other kinds of things, but and there's a YouTube channel, and apparently a Pinterest pages, and you know, whatever. But that is not necessarily stuff that is managed or maintained by the company.
Any other comments? Yep. Excellent.
I would just add at Science, we had a similar experience in the week. We have created social networks that are kind of attractive to a small group of people that are kind of the avid followers or the sometimes thought leaders for that area, but it remains a small group. And then when we create Facebook pages around a particular subject, we get an enormous amount of traffic that is driven from Facebook. So I think going to where the customers, the users are is certainly where we've had success.
Okay, well, I think we're almost out of time, but does anyone, what time are we due to finish? 2:15? In 2 minutes. Okay, well, I won't skip on to another question unless it's, no, I don't think so. I think we dealt with this morning. So I'd like to thank the panel, and I'd like you to join me in thanking the panel for all of their efforts, and especially with my punctuation.